good to see everybody here this evening on a balmy January night. And I tell you what, we'll take it, amen. All this, just think about it. If it was colder, all this would have been snow. Thank the Lord it's warm, amen. You don't have to shovel rain. And that's okay with me, amen. And it's good to see you here tonight. Glad you made it in. Looking forward to a good service together this evening. Take a songbook, will you? Let's start by singing together. Number 323, Standing on the Promises. Standing on the Promises of Christ my King. You got to stand up to sing this, so let's all stand up. Brother Bob will lead us.
Stand on promises of Christ my King. Through eternal ages let it praise. I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of standing on the promises I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
All right, good singing tonight, and let's open with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you, Lord, for the promises we have to stand upon. Thank you, Lord, for the precious promises of your word. And Lord, one of those promises is where when two or three are gathered together, there you are in the midst. And so, Lord, we gather together in your name tonight, knowing that you're here to speak to us and to help us and to minister to each one of us. And Lord, we're grateful. And I pray, God, that you will speak to our hearts tonight and that we'll be yielded to what you want to do in each one of our lives. Father, bless the music, bless our fellowship together, our prayer time, and then Lord, bless the study of your word tonight. Use it in our lives. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, you may be seated.
413, would you turn with me please? 413, I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, but love lifted me. Let's sing that first together.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, from the water lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, when nothing else could help. Love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help. Love lifted me. Ever to him I cling, in his blessed presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true merits my soul's best song. Faithful, loving service to him belongs. Love lifted me, when nothing else could help. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love. protected me. Souls in danger, look above. Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea. Billows his will obey. He your savior wants to be saved today.
Got our missionary letter tonight from the Morrisseys, and they are, of course, in the Philippines, where they're home on deputation right now. He said, it's hard to believe 2016 is over. It truly was an incredible year in so many ways. I can't even begin to tell of all God's blessings throughout the year, but I'll try to give you an overview. We traveled nearly 39,000 miles with many close calls, but not a single accident. We were able to present our ministry in 87 different churches. We had the privilege of leading souls to Christ all across the country, from Johnston, Rhode Island, to Los Angeles, California. Most importantly, we stayed overnight in 98 different locations, and we never one time left a child behind. Okay, there we go. And a successful year. There ought to be a special reward in heaven for that. I could go on and on, but I need to move on to the events of the last couple months. We had a great holiday season with my parents and some of my siblings. It was particularly special due to the fact that it will be our last Christmas in the States for a very long time. We also got to spend some time with Ruth's side of the family right before Christmas. I'm very happy my children were able to enjoy one more Christmas with their grandparents on this side of the ocean. But don't feel sorry for us. My kids have it made. Next year, they'll be spending Christmas with Grandpa Christensen in the Philippines. God's kindness to our family is absolutely amazing. The final phase of deputation, I think I can officially say we are in the final phase of our deputation. In the 2 months since our last prayer letter, 5 new churches have begun supporting us, pushing us over the 80% mark of our needed support. As of right now, I have scheduled meetings up till the end of May, and Lord willing, we'll be on the field by July or early August. Thank you so much for your prayers. We are almost there. On March 28th, I will be taking a 2-week trip to the Philippines to look for housing options. I don't think I could be any more excited. It makes it seem so real. I'm not particularly excited about traveling alone, but if Ruth came, the cute little terrorist would have to come too. I think that's his children. If you think that would be a good idea, you've never gone house hunting on a motorcycle during hot season in the Philippines. True. Finding a house in Dapitan will be our first big challenge, but I'm praying that God will bless my way and allow me to find a house during the trip. Here's the prayer request. Please pray for safety as we travel, particularly during these winter months. Pray that God will allow us to fill the remaining slots in our spring schedule, that God would guide me as I look for a home for our family, and that he would quickly raise the remaining 20% of our needed support. Thank you for your friendship, your prayers, your faithful support. It's a joy to partner with you in our efforts to reach the Philippines with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And if you get their letter, it'll be in the missionary book down on the table. And there's also a soul winning story in there about how he led a couple to the Lord because of a hamburger. All right, you figure that out when you'll get to read that story. It's a great story. All right, got your prayer guide ready? Anybody need one tonight? Put your hand up. Everybody get covered? Okay, wonderful. And we'll start on the back with our coming events. And the RU Inside tomorrow night down at CRC. And then a Performance Unanimous right here Friday nights at 7. And then our normal soul winning and bus visitation, 10 a.m. on Saturday. Remember, Sunday morning, the Sharpetta family will be here, and both in Sunday school and in the morning service, and that'll be a great service together. We look forward to that. Men's breakfast on the 21st. There's a sign-up sheet for that downstairs, as well as the ladies' night out on the 23rd. And so get your names on that and be ready to get that started here in January of 2017. All right. On the inside, we praise the Lord for 17 at RU last Thursday night at the prison. We had 6 new men there and 5 received Christ as their Savior. And a great start to the new year. They did not have it at London on Saturday, but Lord willing, they'll be able to get started there this Saturday. All right. Continue to pray for the church ministries there. Underneath the health list, there's a couple things. I want you to add a name right now, if you would. If you'd add Susie Kimball. Susie is a real faithful lady at Reformers Unanimous on Friday night and watches faithfully every service. She takes care of a mother at home that has Alzheimer's. But Susie is in the hospital tonight. She has a blood clot in her lung. And she's over at Mount Carmel East in intensive care. And so please pray for Susie tonight. Would you please, Susie Kimball? And I know that she would appreciate that. And then at the top, Paula Ross. Most of you know, this is, I don't think I'm mistaken. I think this is Paula Ross's 7th month in the hospital. And she is not doing well, okay? Very serious complications have come in. She's back at Mount Carmel West, and they have some important decisions to make, whether they'll do an additional surgery or not. Not sure if it'll help. It could be life-threatening if they do, the doctor feels or the surgeon feels. So they got some real difficult choices to make. But I think one thing we need to do, it's just gone on so long. Ronnie is taking care of himself, which is enough. He's not in real good health, but he also takes care of her dad, who's 85 years of age. And these two guys have been handling it for almost 7 months with no woman around. And I really think we need to step up and help them a little bit. Okay, we need some folks who maybe twice a week would take a meal to them. That they can surely stretch it out over a few days and such, but that would help. Maybe there'd be a lady who would say, you know what, I'll go over and clean their house. I don't know if you know it, but, you know, there's a difference between a man cleans and a woman cleans, okay? Just saying. So if you can help with that, I mean, how many would be willing to help? I'll contact you or I'll have someone contact you, but you'd be willing to help once a week and take a meal in. Just on a basis. I got Leanne. I got Taylor. Who else is back there? I got Emma. Got Courtney. Got Wallace. Okay. Good. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Good. Great. Okay. All right, that's excellent. Okay, we'll be in touch with you folks, and we'll get that together. I just think that would be a real help and a blessing to them. But pray for Paula, if you would. And she can get visitors. If some of you ladies would like to go up and be an encouragement to her, I think she could use the encouragement. Okay, so she's at Mount Carmel West. Okay? All right. So continue to pray for the others on the list here. We have Carol Coleman's out tonight ill. Neil Parrish is out sick. Good to have a couple back with us that have been sick. Good to see Cindy Taylor here tonight. And good to see Lydia back tonight. Good to see you here this evening. And good to have these folks here. So continue to pray for these on the health list, if you would. I know they really appreciate it. We continue to pray for those in authority. And, of course, we pray for our military, those who are watching over us and protecting us, and we're praying for these with cancer, and we pray for these on the salvation list. We're also praying for the unreached people groups, and then, of course, our missionaries tonight, highlighted by the Morrisseys, who will be going to the Philippines. All right. Want to go ahead and pray. Brother Polabel, make your way up here, would you please? And I'm going to have Brother Polabel lead us in our prayer this evening for the requests we've had tonight. And as he leads us audibly, pray along with him silently. That's the way to keep your mind from wandering away to other things. As he mentions something, you just mention it to the Lord as well. God's a big God. He can hear everybody at once. Okay? And so you just let unite our hearts together in prayer. Brother John, you come.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us, and thank you for the way you watched over us and protected us. We ask that you'd be with us now as we hear the word of God preached to us, and that we would be able to use it in our daily lives. And we thank you for this church that we have that preaches the word of God and faithfully each and every time we come together. And we thank you for the Bible that we have here that we can open and follow along. And some places don't even have Bibles, so we just thank you for ours. And thank you for the ones that are preaching it throughout the day on Sunday morning, the Sunday school teachers and the nursery workers and the 4 and 5 year olds and the junior churches. And we pray that you'd be with them and give them the wisdom and the knowledge they need as they stand before the children and give out the word of God. And we pray that if there's one here that does not know you as Lord and Savior, that tonight would be the night that they get saved. Ask Jesus Christ to come into their heart and forgive them of their sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And we pray for our missionaries that are around the world. Some of them are getting up, and we just pray that you would give them the wisdom and that they need as they set out to serve you. And those that are going to sleep, we just pray they get a good night's sleep and that you'd help them through the night and the next day. And we ask that you would be with the offerings that we have, that we take each day and each time we come together, and we ask that each person would give that you would bless them with. And then we pray for this, the one thing we're taking up the quarters and the dollars to help get Bibles to the unreachables. And we pray that you'd help us with this ministry we have. And then we pray for the RU that we have. We hear good things back from the RU, and we pray that it continue to grow, and that the men that would come out of there would be saved and want to serve you in the churches around the neighborhood and around the country here. And we ask that you'd be with them. And we thank you for the other ministries we have here, the live stream and our encouragement each day throughout the week. We thank you for that. And we pray that you'd bless the people that listen to that and that they'll be able to get something from it each day of the week. And we just pray that you'd be with Paula, and they'll be able to decide what's the best way to work this situation she's with. And then we do pray for Ronnie and his dad, father-in-law, that you'll be able to help them make it through through their daily task of being together. And we do pray for this Susan. We pray that you'd help them, help her, and she's in the hospital, but she's listens to RU and everything on the message, and we pray that you'd help her. And then we pray that you'd be with each one of us now as we set up and listen to the word of God preached, and obey in Jesus' name. Amen.
181:80. Be not dismayed, whate'er betide. God will take care of you. Would you stand with me as we sing? 180. On that first, let's sing it together. Be not dismayed, whate'er betide. God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide. God will take care of you. Third together. All you may need, he will provide. God will take care of you. Nothing you ask will be denied. God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day. Let's greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. sing that chorus together. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you. No matter what may be the test, God will take care of you. Let's sing that last all together. No matter what may be the test, God will take care of you. Lean weary one upon his breast, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day.
Singing, you can be seated, and ushers will come and get our midweek offering tonight, and be prepared to give, and we'll ask Brother Taylor to lead us in our prayer tonight.
Okay, let us pray. Dear Father, we thank you for this great day that you've given us, Lord, and this house to worship in together. Lord, as we take up this offering, may it be pleasing to you. Help us all, Lord, to have that heart, that cheerful heart that you so like to see out of your children, Lord. Father, be with the pastor as he opens up the word and teaches us tonight. Help us all to be attentive. Show us what you would have us to learn and apply to our lives, Lord. Give you all the praise, honor, and glory for all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Take your Bible this evening, if you would. Go to Romans chapter 8, please. Romans chapter 8. Two verses that we'll read together this evening. I'll read for you tonight. I'll read 28 and 29. You follow along with me, if you will. Where the Bible says, "And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren." Father, add your blessing to the reading of our scripture here this evening. And Father, we pray you'll open our understanding as we look into your word tonight. Lord, I pray you'll give us the help of the Holy Spirit as only he can help. Lord, I pray that I'll be able to make the truth clear and understandable, and the folks will listen carefully to what the Spirit would say to their heart tonight. And Lord, I pray that as a result of being here in this service and our studying this passage of Scripture this evening, that we'll be able to leave in a little bit having fulfilled your purpose for our life. And so, Lord, guide us and direct us in these next few minutes as we look into your word. In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. What's the objective of the Christian life? Ever think about that? What's the objective of the Christian life? Let me ask you a question. What's the objective of a car salesman? Yeah, better sell cars. All right. What's the objective of a sports team? Yeah, win. Win the game. And you understand, if you ever get your focus off the objective, or if you get it onto the wrong objective, you'll never fulfill the proper objective. Okay? And when you ask people the objective of the Christian life, you begin to get different answers. Some say, well, the objective of the Christian life is to win others to Christ, convert the world, carry out the gospel. That's the objective of the Christian life. Somebody else says, no, it's the love. I mean, if I can do all those things and don't have charity, I'm nothing. Jesus said that all men will know you're my disciples because you love one another. So the most important thing, the objective of the Christian life, is to love one another. And someone else says, no, it's doctrinal purity and doctrinal unity and making sure we're true and lined up with the Bible. And by the way, all those things are good. Nothing wrong with any one of those objectives. We ought to win people to Christ. We ought to love others and show love by the way we live. And we certainly ought to be doctrinally pure and doctrinally right with the Bible. But that's not the main objective of the Christian life. And the good news is God didn't leave it for us to guess as to what it is. He just told us, and you just read it tonight in verses 28 and 29. Look at it again. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them are called according to His purpose. For whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate to be conformed to what? The image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. The great objective, listen, of the Christian life is that you and I be conformed to the image of His Son. That we be conformed to the image of Christ. All right? Now, the truth is, that doesn't happen overnight. That's a process. That's why I think it's become much easier for believers to think, well, my objective is just give the gospel to somebody. Because that's a whole lot easier than having God work on me. You understand? Oh, no, the objective is for me just to love somebody and try to do good things for other people. Because that's a whole lot easier than God hands-on in my life. So we understand that we kind of want to take the easier way out. 2 Corinthians 3 and verse 18, and we'll look at this verse later, but it says this, but we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. So it's a process. Now, when it says to be conformed to His image, the word conform there is to be a copy or a representation or a likeness. So what the Lord says, He says, what I want to do is, when you're saved, you become a new creature in Christ. And now you're a new creation. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to mold you. I'm going to conform you. I'm forming you to look like my Son. To be in the likeness of my Son. Now, that is not a physical likeness. It is a spiritual likeness. My brother-in-law, my wife's brother, his dad's in heaven now, but he was a chip off the block, if you say, okay? He told the story several years ago. He was in Washington, D.C., and they were at the Vietnam Memorial looking at it, and a man walked up to him. I mean, this is Washington, D.C. He lives in North Carolina, and this man walked up to him and said, are you Don Lesh's son? How about that? And this guy was from Ohio, knew Rick's dad, and he looked so much like him, he said, it's got to be Don Lesh's son. And he went up and asked him, and of course he said, yes, I am. He had that much of a resemblance, that much of a likeness. And that's what the Lord is looking for in you and me, but it's not the outward appearance. It's an inward transformation. And we'll see that as we unfold this here this evening, all right? Let's see, what does God use to conform us? What does God use to form us into the likeness of Jesus Christ? All right, number one, the Bible says he'll use all things to conform us. That's Romans 8:28. Romans 8:28 may be the most misused verse in Scripture. And it helps us to understand just exactly what it's saying. All things work together for good to them that love God. The million-dollar question is, what is good? All things work together for good. And you know, let's think about this. Think about wealth. I mean, most people think if I got a large sum of money, that would be good. However, books have been written about people who have won the lottery and received large sums of money, and they curse the day they won it. They say it's the worst day of their life. And it has ruined many lives. And so it may not be wealth. In fact, Jesus warned us many times about putting our trust in worldly riches and overlooking the true riches. To lay not up for ourselves treasures on earth, but to lay up for ourselves treasures in heaven. And so I don't think good here means wealth or having money. Well, if it's not wealth, what about health? Could it mean that good here, all things work together for good, is that health? We get sick and we pray, Lord, heal me. Heal my sickness. Give me back my health. And we pray for that. And God is the healer. There are no divine healers. There is one divine healer, and that's God. God can heal, and he does. But the question comes, does God always want us healed? And does God always want us healed? Does God ever heal someone by taking them to heaven? See? Certainly that's healing. We don't look at it that way because we didn't get to keep them here. But certainly they are healed when they go to heaven. But you know, sometimes, in fact, you remember the Apostle Paul had to say about one of the men who worked for him, Trophimus. He had to write Timothy, and he said, Trophimus, have I left at Miletum sick? Paul said, I had to leave him there sick. So not everybody gets healed. In fact, Paul had some kind of infirmity that he prayed three times for the Lord to remove it, and the Lord said, no, you need that. Because by having that infirmity, you will rely upon me. So there are times that the good can't be healing. And just in passing here, I'll say again, and I'll deal with this in a message here soon, but don't listen and don't believe people who say there's healing in the atonement. The healing in the atonement is the healing from our sin and healing from the penalty of sin. When someone gets sick, don't say, oh, just God heal them now, and by your stripes we're healed. No, by his stripes we're healed from the penalty of sin. But there's not all healing there. Try to, you know, think about this. Can you just be logical about it? If God's will is always to heal, you would never die. There is time. Eventually, we're going to get sick and we're going to die. It's sin works in our body, and the wages of sin is death. It's still death. And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. And so sometimes illness and even injuries can be vehicles, obviously, by which not only does God work in our life. There's several in here tonight. I guarantee you, you would point to a time when you were sick or you were injured when God got your attention and changed your life. And so God uses that. And he draws us closer to Him through that. Well, is good then mean that we never have to go through any grief or personal loss? Huh? Is that what all things work together for good means? All of us know that being a Christian doesn't exclude us from grief or personal loss. It doesn't exclude us from losing a loved one. It doesn't exclude us from having to deal with miscarriages. Doesn't exclude us from having to deal with maybe losing everything through a house fire. Does it? We're not exempt from those sort of things. It's just for those reasons that people misuse Romans 8:28. There's nothing worse than looking at someone who goes through a fire or who has lost a loved one or has just suffered a loss of loved one, maybe in a tragic car accident, and someone walk up to them and say, well, you know, God says it'll all work together for good. I wouldn't be surprised if somebody punched you in the face if you said that. That's not what that verse is talking about. We often don't understand what God is doing. You ever been there? You ever wonder what exactly God are you up to? You ever known that God does things and doesn't consult you first as to whether you agree with it or not? Or whether you even understand it? Spouse dies or a loved one's diagnosed with cancer or Alzheimer's or a child is discovered using drugs or a friend turns against you or the car breaks down or so if it's not health, it's not wealth, it's not exemption from any difficulties or problems or grief or loss, what is the good that Romans 8:28 is talking about? All things work together for good. To them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. Now we're getting warm. We love God and we're called according to His purpose. What was the purpose again? What was the objective of the Christian life? To be conformed to the image of His Son. And so the key phrase in understanding the good purpose of God is that God's going to work everything together. God's at work and He's working the circumstance of life together to conform me to the image of His Son. And that's a much higher, loftier goal than just everything will be good for me. Everything will be good in my eyes. Everything will work out good for me or come out all right in my sight. Matthew Henry said this. He said, to be spirited as Christ was, in other words, to have the Spirit of Christ, to walk and live as Christ did, to bear our sufferings patiently as Christ did. Christ is the express image of the Father, and we are conformed to the image of Christ. The flesh sees the circumstances of life, and you know what the flesh wants to know? Why? Why are you doing this? Why did this happen? What is going on? But you know, the Spirit of God in us says, not your will, but thine be done. God's will be done. That God accomplish His purpose in our life. So no matter what takes place, I know that God will work it together for me to be more conformed to the image of His Son, Jesus Christ. You know what? That's what I want. That's the objective. That's the goal. And so I'm glad to have that promise. We go back to this. The first sin in the garden. They ate of the tree of the knowledge of what? Good and evil. What was Satan telling Eve? You don't decide what's good and evil. I mean, you don't let God decide that. You ought to decide that. Up to that point, who decided what's good and evil? God did. I said, no. Who do you think God is? You ought to have that right. You ought to be able to decide good and evil. And listen, that's still the struggle that we go through today. We want to determine whether something's good or bad. A loved one dies, that's bad. You get sick and don't get healed, that's bad. I have bills and or something unexpected comes up and I can't pay, that's bad. No, it may be the best thing ever happened to you. You can't determine good or bad. That's God's department. Boy, that's quiet. I can tell that's popular. His good, hey, how many of you when you were younger, your dad, your mom spanked you? I mean, they gave you the paddle or the belt where you had the padding, okay? They applied the Board of Education to the seat of learning, okay? And how many of that happened to, okay? Now, let me ask you this. How many of you thought that was good at the time? Huh? Yeah. How many had a mom or dad that said, now this hurts me more than it hurts you? Huh? Hey, by the way, as a parent, you understand that, don't you? It does. One of the hardest things you'll ever do is spank your child. If your heart is right, that's one of the hardest things you ever do. You need to do it. You do it right, and you do it properly. But listen, nobody thinks that's good. In fact, Hebrews says God chastens us, and none of us think that's enjoyable. But let me ask you a question. How many of you look back now and say, you know what? That was good for me. How many of you think that now? Yeah. You see, we can go through things in life and think, man, this isn't any good. This isn't right. I don't like this. Or we can say, He knows what's good. He knows what's good better than I know what's good. And I will take it because God is working all things together to conform me to the image of His Son, Jesus Christ. William Carey is the father of modern missions. He faced a real disappointment and really of overwhelming proportions. Carey began his missionary career in India in 1793. Listen, he labored in the country of India for 40 continuous years, never one time returning home. That's a long time without a furlough, isn't it? He was an incredible translator of scriptures. He translated portions of scripture into over a dozen Indian languages. One afternoon, after 20 years of labor in that country, a fire raged through his printing plant and warehouse. All of the printing equipment was destroyed. But most tragically, many of his precious manuscripts were completely consumed by the fire. Carey, obviously, he couldn't go to the cloud and get them back. No backup, no computer, they're gone. How would he respond to such crushing devastation? William Carey wrote a letter to his friend Andrew Murray, might be a familiar name to some of you, who also was in England. And he said this, quote, "The ground must be labored over again, but we are not discouraged. We have all been supported under the affliction and preserved from discouragement. To me, the consideration of divine sovereignty and wisdom has been very supporting. I endeavor to improve this, our affliction, last Lord's Day from Psalm 46:10. Be still and know that I am God." I principally dwelt on two ideas. God has a sovereign right to dispose of us as He pleases. And we ought to acquiesce in all that God does with us and to us. In other words, Carey's saying, I understand God can do whatever He wants to do with my life. And if He wants to burn up the printing place and the manuscripts and we start over, then that's okay with me. That's all right. It's conforming me more to the image of Christ. I'm telling you, We don't think like that. We don't have that thought process. But we need to have that to be conformed to the image of His Son. Okay, so God uses all things. Okay? Then, secondly, He uses the Spirit of God to conform us to Christ. Prior to verse 28, verse 26, 27 says, "The Spirit also helps our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God." So here's the thing. In these circumstances that come up, and again, in our eyes, as we think of good and evil, we think these things aren't good, or something's not great that we're going through, but God says it's good. How can we handle that? How can we get our, say, "I just can't wrap my mind about that"? Well, then God gave you a helper as a believer, and it's the Holy Spirit of God. He is the one called alongside to help. He's the one that helps us see what we're... He helps us keep our eye on the goal of what God's doing. He knows the mind and the perfect will of God. And He helps us. Helps us pray according to His will. And He gives us the grace to say, "Not my will, but thine be done." And can I just say, He's the only spirit guide you ever need. Don't get messed up with any other spirits. So Paul, if you know much about Romans 8, it is all about the Spirit. Romans 7 was all about the struggle with the flesh, and then Romans 8 is all about the Spirit, how He helps us and prays for us and assures us. And you know, the Spirit of God always, He already sees the finished product. Look again in verse 29. "Whom He did foreknow, He did predestinate to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren." Now look at verse 30. "Moreover, whom He did predestinate, them He also called. And whom He called, them He also justified. And whom He justified, them He also glorified." But those are all in the past tense. It's already happened. In the mind of God, it's already taken place. Nobody here tonight's been glorified, at least in practice yet. But God sees us as if we're glorified. And the Spirit of God will help us to keep focused on the goal and not get sidetracked. And that's why He says, if God be for us, who can be against us? Hey, stay with it. It's Christ who died, was raised up, and He's at the right hand of God, and He's interceding for you too. I mean, it doesn't get much better than that. The Holy Spirit within us to help us and to encourage us and to keep us focused. Jesus interceding for us at the right hand of God. Hey, that's a whole lot better to me than, well, you know, everything happens for a reason. That just gets pretty empty. Then, you know, God is forming me, conforming me to the image of His Son, Jesus Christ. And then, you know, He says nothing's going to separate us from the love of Christ. Nothing's going to stop God or thwart God from accomplishing His purpose in our lives. Nothing's going to get Him off track. And if He gave His Son for us all, how much more will He give us all things? The Spirit of God helps us through His work to conform us to the image of Jesus Christ. He accomplishes His purpose in us. And the Holy Spirit's purpose in us, listen, the Holy Spirit, Jesus said when He comes, He will speak of me. Nobody is filled with the Spirit who only talks about the Spirit. Nobody is filled with the Spirit who says, "Everybody, look at me." When you're filled with the Spirit, it'll be, "Look at Jesus." Everything will point to Jesus. It won't point to yourself. It'll all be about Christ. That's a Spirit-filled life, and that's being like Jesus. Third thing that the Lord uses to conform us to the image of Christ is He uses the Word of God. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 3, will you? That's the verse we quoted earlier, and I want you to look at it. 2 Corinthians 3, and it's verse number 18. In fact, it goes along with these afflictions and these things that happen to us that we're not sure are good for us. In fact, look at verse 16. 2 Corinthians 3, 16. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet our inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but things which are not seen. For the thing, oh, I'm reading chapter 4, aren't I? I'll get back to chapter 3 in a minute. Go to 4 with me, will you? He said, we're not looking at things that are seen, but look at things that are that are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, things which are not seen are eternal. He's helping us with our affliction and our problems now to see the big picture. And the big picture, again, is God's conforming us to the image of His Son. Now, He does that, the last verse of chapter 3, we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass, the glory of the Lord. That's like a mirror. We're looking through a mirror. We're looking in here and we're seeing Jesus Christ. Okay? And it says, you look in the Bible, you see Jesus. We're changed into the same image from glory to glory. How does that happen? Even as by the Spirit of the Lord. So the Word of God, the Spirit of God will use the Word of God to fashion us, to make us into the likeness of Christ. And you get that by the Word of God. Do you understand? The Bible, when you get saved, it says, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of what? The Word. That you can do what? Grow thereby. Grow thereby. Look over to 2 Timothy chapter 3. Would you turn there, please? 2 Timothy chapter 3. Familiar verses to you. Paul here writing to Timothy, and he's encouraging him about something. And notice chapter 3 and verse 14. Paul writes, but continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, complete, throughly furnished unto all good works. It says that happens by the Word of God. You as you spend time with the Lord Jesus and you spend time in His Word, the Bible's unlike any other book. Look at Hebrews chapter 4. Keep going to your right and you'll see the book of Hebrews. Look at Hebrews chapter 4 and notice with me verse number 12. Hebrews 4 and verse 12. If you're there, you say amen. All right. For the Word of God is what? Quick. What's that mean? It's fast? No. Quick means alive. It means living. Did you know what you have in your lap tonight's a living book? Did you know that book's alive? You know, it'll work in your life. It'll do. That's why somebody said, well, I read the Bible. I don't remember anything. That's okay. It did its work. It'll do its work in you, whether you consciously remember it or not. It will do a work in you. Notice what it says. It's quick and it is alive and it's powerful. And it's sharper than any two-edged sword because it pierces to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, of the joints and the marrow. It's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. God says, you know what the Word of God does? It divides between what you want and what God wants. It divides between what you think is okay and what God says is okay. And it's sharp enough to make that decision. And it divides, it'll make the way clear. That's why it says, your word, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. It shows me the way to go. Now, you're going to have the decision to make, which way am I going to go? But you're going to know because of the Word of God. It, as you spend time with God's Word and you read it and you study it and you memorize it and you meditate in it, God, as we talked about last week, God changes your thinking. He changes your thinking. You get renewed in your mind. You begin to send new thought patterns in your brain. Different, they travel a different path. And the things you used to do, you don't do them anymore. And habits begin to change. And you begin to follow what He wants and not what you want. There is no other book like the Bible. And let me help you. Nothing replaces the Bible. I'm not opposed to devotional books, not opposed to things that may help you, and that's fine if you want to take time to read that, but don't let that replace your Bible reading. You still need to read the Bible. Devotional books are good, but they're not alive, they're not quick and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. Only God's Word is. It's been given by inspiration of God. And when I read that, I behold in His Word the image of Christ. You know what happens? God begins to change me into that image. How? My thoughts change. My attitudes change. My priorities change. My speech changes. My habits change. My appearance changes. All those things begin to take place. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Behold, old things are passed away, and behold, all things are become new. And the next first phrase of the next verse says, and all things are of God. See, all things are of God. And that process begins to take place in our lives. He uses the Word of God. That's how important the Bible is. And then let me give you number four. And that is simply this. It's God's predetermined will that we conform to His Son. Go back to Romans 8, will you please? Romans chapter 8. Look again at verse 29. The Bible says, whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate. Now, when He says He did foreknow, it simply means this. God knows, by the way, God knows everything. God knows who will believe in Him and receive Christ, and God knows who won't. God has not predetermined who's going to trust Him and who isn't going to trust Him, because He gave man a free will. And we have that obligation. Jesus looked at a group of people one day and He said, you will not come to Me that ye might have life. Now, if God predetermined that they were damned to hell and they could not be saved, then Jesus lied when He said, you will not come to Me. What He really should have said, to be truthful, was, you cannot come to Me that you might have life, because God didn't wire you that way. But He said, He didn't say you cannot, He said you will not. What kept those people from coming to Christ? Their own will. And so when you want, if somebody wants to be saved, He will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. So foreknowledge is simply knowing. Predestination, here it says, He didn't predestine us to be saved. He predestinated us to be conformed to the image of His Son. I tell you what God did predestinate for every single believer, and that is He predestinated or predetermined that we would be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. That's His predetermined will. Boy, that takes away the, hey man, I'm saved, that's all that matters. Oh no, that's not all that matters. God has predetermined that you be like Christ. He's predetermined that we be conformed to the image of His Son. That we be conformed. We be like Christ in our attitudes, in our spirit, in our speech, in our actions, in our appearance. That is His will for every Christian, every believer. And He uses all things. He uses His Spirit indwelling us. He uses the Word of God. God is molding us into the likeness of His Son. You see, the mind of Christ is supposed to be our mind. The works of Christ, the works that He did, greater works than these are we supposed to do. His attitudes are to be our attitudes. 1 Peter 2:21, He's given us an example that we should follow His steps. He's our example. You know, Jesus cared for people in society. He cared for people that society didn't want. The lame, the halt, the blind, the lepers. He loved the unlovely. I read the story this week of a man who's visiting a home for the mentally ill. For an hour or so, he talked with a young woman named Mary, a girl whose body was just covered with tumors. As the conversation came to a close, he put his arm around her and he said, "Mary, you really are a beautiful person." Mary said, "Thank you. No one's ever gotten close enough to notice. No one's ever gotten close enough to notice." You know what Jesus did? He got close enough to notice. He got close enough to touch people's lives when their lives weren't pretty. Max Lucado, who's an author, said this in one of his books. He said, "When God chose to reveal Himself to mankind, what medium did He use? Did He use a book? Not in primary place, as a secondary place. Did He use a church? No. That was a consequence of Him revealing Himself. Did He use a moral code? No. To limit God's revelation to a list of just do's or don'ts is as tragic as looking at a road map of Colorado and say, I saw the Rocky Mountains. When God chose to reveal Himself, He did so through a human body. The tongue that called forth the dead was a human one. The hand that touched the leper had dirt under its nails. The feet upon which the woman wept were calloused and dirty. And His tears, they came from a heart as broken as yours or mine has ever been." So people came to Him. Boy, did they come to Him. From every walk of life. They came at night. They touched Him as He walked down the street. They followed Him around the sea. They invited Him to their homes. They put children at His feet. Why? Because He refused to be a statue in a cathedral or a priest in an elevated pulpit. He just chose to be Jesus. And we are called to be like Him. That's our job. R.G. Lee was a great preacher. How many have heard or listened to Adrian Rogers on the radio? Of course, Adrian Rogers is in heaven now. Bellevue Baptist Church. The one who pastored Bellevue Baptist Church for 40 or 50 years prior to Adrian Rogers was R.G. Lee. Amazing preacher. And has a famous sermon. You ought to look it up sometime on, I'm sure they probably have it on YouTube, or you can find it somewhere, called Payday Someday. Famous sermon. And R.G. Lee lived into his 90s. In fact, I think he was still preaching in his early 90s. He came up to preach at the First Baptist Church in Hammond, Indiana, and I think he was 91 at the time. There's an associate pastor there on staff, Johnny Colston. Oh my, Brother Colston's been there since the early 60s, so he's been there 50 to 55 years now, I'm sure. And he was to take care of R.G. Lee while he was there. Pick him up from the motel, make sure he had a meal with him, make sure he's in the, you know, where he was supposed to be, when he was supposed to be. He was kind of like his host while he's there for several days. And as they were being driven back to the airport, he was sitting in the back seat with R.G. Lee, and the man was driving. R.G. Lee looked over at Johnny Colston as they got to the Hare Airport, and he began to get out. He said, "Sir, I want to tell you something." He said, "You remind me more of Jesus Christ than any man I've ever met. Wow. You imagine that? What a compliment. You won't get a better compliment than that. But that's what we're all supposed to be. We're supposed to be like Him. Oh, to be like Thee. Oh, to be like Thee, precious Redeemer, pure as Thou art. Come in Thy sweetness, come in Thy fullness, stamp Thine own image deep on my heart. What should we be? Be conformed to the image of His Son. Let's bow for prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before You this evening. I thank You, Lord, for this clear passage in Romans 8, 28, 29. Thank You, Lord, for making it clear to us what the objective of the Christian life is. That You are working in us to be conformed to the image of Christ. That You desire, that You mold us and shape us to be like Jesus. You'll use all things. You'll work them towards that good of us being like Jesus. You'll use the Word of God. You'll use the Spirit of God in us. Thank You for helping us by giving us Your Holy Spirit. And Lord, impress upon us tonight that it is Your predetermined will for each of us to be yielded to this process in our life. And so we yield to You. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I'm going to finish praying in just a moment. Wonder how many folks tonight would say, "Preacher, the Spirit of God has stopped at my chair this evening. And I realize now what the objective is of the Christian life. I know now what God's doing in my life. He is conforming me to the image of His Son. And I want that. I want to be like Jesus. And I understand now what He's doing. And His objective will be my objective. I want Him to complete the work. It will not be my will, but Thy will be done." Pastor, the Lord has spoke to my heart tonight. Pray for me this evening. Will you slip your hand up, Christian? Say, "Pray for me tonight." Amen. Amen. That's good. You may put them down. And men, I'm going to pray, and we're going to have an invitation this evening. I want to give you opportunity to talk to the Lord tonight. Just yield to Him. Just ask Him to stamp His own image deep on your heart and to make you into that likeness of Jesus. Maybe someday someone would say to you, "You remind me of Jesus Christ." Heavenly Father, have Your way in this invitation, please. May Your will be done in each one of our lives now. And hear our prayers. We bow the knee and yield to You tonight. And we'll thank You for that. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. You'll stand to your feet. Lisa's going to play. Brother Bob's going to sing. Lord has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him tonight. Will you please?
Oh, to be like Thee, blessed Redeemer. This is my constant longing and prayer. Gladly I'll forfeit all of earth's treasures, Jesus, Thy perfect likeness to wear. Oh, to be like Thee, oh, to be like Thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as Thou art. Come in Thy sweetness, come in Thy fullness, stamp Thine own image
knowledge deep on my heart. Oh, to be like thee, full of compassion, love forgiving, tender and kind, helping the helpless, cheering the fainting, seeking the wandering sinner to find. Oh, to be like thee, oh, to be like thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as a heart. Come in thy sweetness, come in thy fullness, stamp thine own image deep on my heart. Oh, to be like thee, while I am pleading, pour out thy spirit, fill with thy love. Make me a temple, meet for thy dwelling, fit me for life and heaven above. Oh, to be like thee, oh, to be like thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as thou art. Come in thy sweetness, come in thy fullness, stamp thine own image deep on my heart. Oh, to be like thee, Lord, I am coming now to receive the anointing divine. All that I am and have, I am bringing, Lord, from this moment all shall be thine. Oh, to be like thee, oh, to be like thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as thou art. Come in thy sweetness, come in thy fullness, stamp thine own image deep on my heart.
Be seated for a minute if you would. We are glad to have Tina Johnson coming tonight. Tina talked to me last Wednesday night, and she's been coming. How are you related? Are you related to each other? Is she your aunt? I'm talking to you, Jeanette.
Yes.
Okay, looking at me, smiling like, oh, yeah, yeah.
She
she's your aunt, right?
She is my sister.
She's your sister. Really? Is she telling the truth? I got to check it out, you know. All right. Okay. Tina has been coming for a while, and she talked to me last week, and she had made a profession when she was younger and baptized, but then later in life accepted Christ and knew she was saved, but had not been baptized since she truly was saved. And so she wants to be a member of the church, and so she's coming tonight to follow the Lord in believer's baptism, so she can be a member of Bible Baptist Church. Isn't that great? And Tina, we're thrilled about that. Man, so glad to have you coming. You go follow Mrs. Wallace right downstairs there, and she'll get you ready to be baptized, and we'll baptize Tina this evening. Isn't that great?
Amen.
Amen. You never know what you find when you come to church. Amen. I'm glad I'm here for this tonight. All right. Brother Bob?
Well, let's do a few favorites tonight. Anybody have a favorite? Mrs. Ben Gelder. Number 11, He Is Mine, I believe that is. Number 11, long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He is mine.
Long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He exchanged a sinner for the sinless one. But thine be done, He is mine.
Number 13, one page over, the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. That's a good. Since I started Brother Linderman always has different ones. I like it. Haven of rest, my soul and set exo was out on life's sea, so burdened with sin and distress, till I heard a sweet voice saying, make me your choice, and I entered.
Tina, upon a public profession of your faith in Christ as your Savior, and in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bearing the likeness of Jesus' death, and raised in the likeness of his life. And the servant said, Master, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room.
Amen.
Tell you what, if you ever read that second line of that song, it's a tough song to sing without singing that second verse. Let's sing that second verse, all right? I yielded myself to his tender embrace, and faith took taking hold of the word. My fetters fell off, and I anchored my soul. The haven of rest is my Lord. Let's sing that second together. I yielded myself to his tender embrace, and faith taking hold of the word. My fetters fell off, and I anchored my soul. The haven of rest is my Lord. Temple.
wild stormy deep. In Jesus I'm safe evermore.
Man, there's good truth in that song. I'm going to guarantee you'll be hearing that again soon. Brother Quentin? 45. Let's do this one last one. There we go. It's still the blood.
Once I wandered in sin, black night, and there was no way I could make my wrongs right. Then that old accuser to the Lord did cry, he is a sinner, and now he must die. And it's still the blood that saves from sin. It's still the blood that cleanses within, from the highest star in heaven to the depths of the sea. It's still the blood of Jesus that brings victory to me. Let's sing that last together. There are those who rely on the words that they do, and some men count on the times they pray through. But when the battle's over and my last song is sung, I'll go home through the blood of my Father's precious Son. And it's still the blood that saves from sin. It's still the blood that cleanses within, from that highest star in heaven to the depths of the sea. It's still the blood of Jesus that brings victory to me.
Great job. Well, let's stand together. Man, that's good. I'd say we can just stay here and sing all night, but I know you guys want to go home. Let's pray, and then we'll have our song of dismissal, all right? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for just a great night, great message, Lord. I thank you for giving us such a clear calling, and that is to be conformed into the image of your Son. Lord, I thank you for giving us all the tools for that, your Holy Word and your Holy Spirit. And God, I just am so grateful for who you are and who you want to be in and through us. Lord, I pray that we would just go about our each and every way here, remembering these things, not soon forgetting what you've taught us tonight. Pray that you would give each of us safety as we travel home, and pray that your perfect will would be done in each of our lives this week. In Jesus' precious and holy name I do pray, amen. Let's sing The Windows of Heaven. The windows of heaven are open, the blessings are falling tonight. If you need it, it's 128. On that chorus,
the windows of heaven are open, the blessings are falling tonight. There's joy, joy, joy in my heart, since Jesus made everything right. I gave him my old tattered garment, he gave me a robe of pure white. I'm feasting on manna from heaven, and that's why you're happy. That's why we're happy. That's why I'm happy tonight.
Amen. You're dismissed.